growing in my yard, the horsetail or world, as it's called. And I photographed the metamorphosis of that butterfly to its release. And this is she. I named her Maya in honor of Maya Angelou, who taught us so much about freedom and emergence. And this is really, in addition to seeing Gail and Fiona last year at the Highland Center of Natural History, was what encouraged me to just really chase the monarchs, as you might say. So I want to introduce Gail Morris.
The Southwest Monarch Study here in Arizona and all the Southwest states. I'm also the Monarch Watch Conservation Specialist, and I sit on the board of directors of the Monarch Butterfly Fund. And we fund research at the overwintering sites in Mexico. So hopefully we're going to share some unique information. I know you've read a lot about monarch butterflies in the news lately, about the declining population. We're going to touch on that. But also I want to talk about what's happening with monarchs in Arizona. We just published a paper this summer called Status of Danaus Plexippus in Arizona. It is actually on our website, and if you have not picked up one of these brochures, I'm going to pass them around so you can do so. Our website, Facebook, Twitter, all that is on here, as well as other information. But it's right at the top of the link of the homepage, and for those of you who do not want to delve through 18 pages of scientific jargon, we came up with a shorter 10 key findings, okay? So whatever you're comfortable reading is there. I'd like to share with you that at the beginning, when I first became involved around 8 or 9 years ago with monarch butterflies, everyone was discouraging me from doing so because they said, you know, there just are not many monarchs in Arizona. It's kind of like a waste of time. But we've learned some significant things from that. So I'm going to go further back in history and say many, many years ago, they used to look at the Rocky Mountains as a great divide. There was the eastern population that went down to Mexico, a western population that went along the coast of California all the way into the Baja area down the coast of Mexico. And they really felt that was a barrier. But interestingly enough, when you look at the history, Dr. Urquhart, who was one of the premier people to study monarchs, found that in valleys there was some crossover. Now we're going to jump forward. Dr. Robert Pyle in the 1990s took a trip chasing monarchs from Washington all the way down the coast. And when he hit Arizona, guess what? He started noticing monarchs were flying with a southerly heading. All right, so that was the first official writing that something more that was going on. However, if we talk to people in the field in Arizona, Jim Brock, Rick Bailowitz and others, it's all in the notes. Monarchs were flying south through Arizona during the migration. So we were able to put all this information together in our paper. Around 2003, Chris Klein started the Southwest Monarch Study. He was based in Boyce Thompson Arboretum. He was there to 2009 when he moved back to Ohio and resigned in 2010. And at that point, we all had to make this decision, do we move forward or not? And we decided to stay together, reorganize, and include monarch conservation under our umbrella with our findings, and here we are today as a result of that. You have to be careful when you join groups because you end up the coordinator sometime, right? But you know what? We see some beautiful parts of the state. You know, on the way up today, my husband and I stopped in Wickenburg and picked up these plugs of two kinds of milkweed. We'll get into that in a little bit on the way up. So we came up through Yarnell and through Skull Valley, and it's beautiful, just beautiful. So I feel very fortunate to do what we do. Okay, everyone wants to know how to tell the difference between a male and a female monarch, and so I'm going to start with that. We have two photos, and I'm going to need help here since I've got literally one hand this time. There we go. So we're going to pass these around, and if you forget which one it is, we wrote it on the back for you, okay? We're making this easy. Males on the lower wings have black dots. I don't know if you could see them here. You will when you see them up close. the females have thicker veins. And you know what? If you have one butterfly in front of you, that is all relative, right? You can't tell if the veins are thicker or not. So always look at those lower veins. Luckily, monarchs love to open their wings when they're feeding, so you should be able to see that, all right? So we're gonna pass these around, and I also have some samples of monarchs that died in my yard, so you could see them. They're kind of faded, all right? Their color is lower, but so you could see what it looks like on a real monarch as well. A male, when they have their wings up, it's really hard to see that little black dot. All right, but it's a little bump and it's on the third vein. You'll get to see that in this sample that we're sending around. The other thing that frequently happens is monarchs get confused with queen butterflies in the field. All right, and these are labeled really clearly when we send them around for you. The monarch is on the top, the queen is on the bottom. Anyone tell the difference? White dots. The queen has white dots in the orange. And even those of you in the back will see that soon as this comes back to you, okay? There are white dots in the orange. That is the main way to tell the difference. Sometimes when people send in photos of these and we tell them it's not a monarch, they get really disappointed. I'm excited for you because if you see a queen, you will likely see a monarch when they are here. They're in the same family, the Danaus family. They both use only milkweed as a host plant. And we are so lucky. We have over 30 species of milkweed in Arizona. Okay. So I'm gonna pass this around to look at. Always look for those white dots in the orange.
So do the queens, they don't migrate, right?
You know, they move. So that's a real good point. And I'm trying to find my little queen. I had a little queen, here it is. This is a queen sample that'll go around. They move. Queens will not survive the winter here in the Prescott area. They'll shift further south. We'll see them in the Phoenix area all winter in Tucson, unless there's a hard freeze and that'll wipe them out. They'll sometimes move to northern Mexico, but it's not considered a migration versus a movement. It's all relative as to distance. That's a really good question. Great. We mentioned tagging, and I'd like to talk about what we do with that. So to be able to do that well, we need to talk about what does the migration look like here. We are entering the time that we're about a month to a month and a half before the key migration for this area. It's about mid-September, give or take a couple days either way. The monarchs are starting to already shift further south. About a month before that key migration, and this is what I've been telling everyone, if you are not seeing monarchs now, and there have been a few sightings here, and actually in Sedona and around, about a month before the migration, there is a movement south of monarchs, and they will come through laying eggs, all right? Their offspring will join the main migration. Does that sound confusing enough? So if you haven't seen any monarchs, you still likely will in the next couple of weeks, all right? Normally a monarch butterfly lives 30 days. That's it, 30 days, 2 to 5 weeks. A female during that time will lay 300 to 500 eggs, okay? You'd think we'd see monarchs everywhere, right? But only 5% will become a new butterfly. There are so many predators out there. All right, ants are predators. They'll feed on the eggs, for example. There's tachinid flies that lay their eggs inside monarch caterpillars. So you can see when we see this little egg here, and you're welcome to come up afterwards, because I know in the back you can't see this. We have a poster. When you see the top of that egg darken, that is actually the head of the caterpillar. So nature will give us these beautiful, beautiful cues. And a little caterpillar will come out. And if you go back trying to find that egg, the first thing that caterpillar will do is eat that eggshell. that it just came out of. Okay. It'll grow and it'll molt. It'll change its skin 5 times as it progressively gets larger and larger. Then all of a sudden, when it's the nice big caterpillar that you're used to seeing as a monarch caterpillar, it can often wander away from that milkweed plant, 30 feet or more. I've seen them on hose bins. I've seen them on the top of patio covers. They'll climb all the way up. And some of the most unusual places, sometimes under your chair. When my son was graduating a couple years ago, we were having people over and I was moving chairs and I picked this little glimmer of green, you know, right under the seat. So you have to, when you have caterpillars in your yard, you never know what's going to happen. Sometimes they may stay on the milkweed plant itself or a nearby bush. They'll hang in what we call J. This is called hanging in J. And when you see that happening, that's your cue again that within the next 24 hours, they're going to form a chrysalis and you'll get to have that opportunity to see that happen in front of you. It's a beautiful experience. Again, it's all written out here for you to look at, and they have this beautiful green chrysalis. Now, guess what? Queen chrysalises look very similar. There's a little difference in the number of gold dots. If you get to be really good at it and look at your at the shape, you could pick up the difference. I've seen huge queen ones and small monarch ones, so size is not always a way to tell the difference. After about 9, 10 days, 14 days, depending on the temperature, how cold it is or warm it is, it'll turn clear and you'll actually be able to see the wings. And that's a way of you knowing the next day that monarch will eclose or come out of that chrysalis. And you'll get to see that experience. When they first come out, they're very crumpled. They have to pump the fluid through and they cannot fly. They're very vulnerable to lizards, cats and yards, you know, anything out there. So it's an incredible life cycle that happens here. And this breeding will go on from March when they leave the overwintering sites up until mid-August in most years. And instead of that cycle beginning again, with them breeding again after they come out, in mid-August to beginning of September here in Arizona, they don't breed. They come out of that chrysalis and they eat, and they eat, and they eat. They'll often stay a little longer in your yards or in the fields feeding on nectar. They'll double their weight. And when we're in the fields, you could actually see their abdomens are very plump. What they're trying to do is build up on lipids to make the flight of their migration. So what you have in your yard for flowering plants makes all the difference in the fall. Remember, the monarchs are not breeding then. They're migrating. That generation can live 6 to 9 months. All right? So as long as they do not breed, they can live a long time. The last 2 to 3 falls in Arizona has been very warm. And monarchs that might not have made it in the past have been able to complete that life cycle a little longer. I know we received reports as late as December of freshly eclosed monarchs in the Phoenix area. Some of them breeded all winter, you know, which isn't always a good thing. But they chose not to migrate, but they ended up staying there. Okay, so what happens when we tag them? We put a little blue tag on them. I'm going to send this around. This is on our website of how to tag, and it shows that difference between male and female, and you'll see a little blue tag that we put on the discal cell. So if this was a monarch butterfly flying through here, okay, and we caught it, we would hold it on the back of its wings, so we're holding all 4 wings together so it can flap around. And then we would look for this cell that's kind of a mitten shape. All right, if you look at the picture on your handouts, you could see a little cell that kind of stands out on the lower wing. And that is where we would take a sticker and put the blue sticker. Okay, putting a tag at that location does not affect their flight in any way. It's extremely light, they're extremely durable tags. I'll pass some of those around as well when I can find them. But they are weather resistant, even though they don't normally fly in the rain. keep in mind, they are in the rain. On a rainy day, they'll be in a bush that could get pretty soaked. So we need to make sure those tags stay on. Usually, they'll just fly right off to another flower. Sometimes they'll fly up to a tree after we let them go. We mark if they're male or female. We mark their wing condition. Do they look strong and healthy? We mark where we tag them. And that all goes into a big data bank. So if I tag one in my yard, and you have a monarch in your yard, and you notice a little tag, if you could read that number, we can tell you what it looked like and where it came from. Right? People are tagging up in the state of Washington and Oregon. We keep hoping those tag monarchs will appear here. They're looking for some documentation that they go to Mexico as well. So what did we find? This is what we found. We tagged 12, can I ask you to hold this up for me? Thank you. We tagged over 12,000 monarchs in Arizona, okay? The blue squares are places monarchs were tagged. It could be more than one. In fact, many of them are more than one. The red circles are where locations where people like yourself have emailed us, posted on our Facebook page a picture of a monarch, and say, guess what? At Prescott Creek, look what we found today. And so we found some of these locations were different than where they were tagged. I believe we received around 200 of those. So we had a lot of information. What do you think? Do you think this is a state that has no monarchs? Isn't that amazing? But if you notice, look at the rivers on here. Do you notice? You have a big swallowtail flying around, flowers behind you. They tend to hug areas with some moisture, all right? They don't only stay where there is moisture. I want to be real clear on that. But think of it. More flowers would likely grow in those areas. Milkweed would likely be better and better condition. There's probably taller trees as they're working their way through the state in those areas. So that's a protection against predators as well as a place to sleep, all right? If you look at our paper, you'll see some pictures of night roosting and everything by monarchs here as well. This is the Monarch Watch migration map that they use. Thank you. Okay, thanks. Monarch Watch changed their maps afterwards. If you had seen some of the early maps, they would have had this white all over Arizona. So once we started getting our findings, which learned that some of our monarchs go to California, some of them go to Mexico. In fact, more of our monarchs go to Mexico than would go to California. And so that led to the change in the migration maps. So while we were in the fields a lot, and I'm going to be passing this around, of these to date, we've had 17 what we call recoveries in Mexico. A recovery is when you tag one here, and guess where it's seen next? Mexico. So it's recovered, you know, from another location. And we've had 10 in California, all right? We started getting suspicious because when we looked at how many went to California, it wasn't every year. We had one in 2008, one in 2010. 2013, we had five, all tagged in the same week, all right? Last year, three, all tagged in the same week. So several of us are weather spotters for the National Weather Service, and we went back to them, and we did some studies about wind direction. And we learned from Dr. David Debo, who did studies many years ago about the migration, monarchs like to ride thermals in the fall. They have a long way to go, right? They have a long way to go. Flapping those wings constantly takes a lot of energy. So they'll ride a thermal. So when you see the hawks thermally, get your binoculars. A lot of times you could see the monarchs joining them, and they will fly at about 1,000 feet to their destination. So we went and pulled the wind direction. And my husband, Bob, had a lot to do with this. He did a lot of this data mining. We went to the National Weather Service in Phoenix, who referred us to the Tucson, who referred us to the National Storm Center, who had the data at 1,000 feet that we needed in this area. This was only in southeast Arizona that we've been able to verify it. And we looked at all the dates that we had recoveries, and we plotted them on a graph, and we were amazed at what we found. Because we found when the wind comes from the southeast to the northwest, like it does a lot during this time of year, during the monsoons at the beginning of September, guess where our monarchs were found? California. When they went the other way, when the wind came from the northwest to the southeast, we had recoveries in Mexico. Okay, and after a certain point, when we hit the key migration, everything's in Mexico. So you could see all that in on our paper. So whenever we have these California ones, it's because they're being affected by wind. Sometimes four were tagged in the same field, all going to the same place, all in California or all in Mexico. So it's kind of an interesting finding. I'm going to pass this around. You may be wondering what five farm butterflies are. Desert Botanical Gardens in Phoenix for several years did a tag and release of butterflies. They imported them in from butterfly farm in California, tagged them in with the public in Phoenix, and let them go. And guess where they went? Mexico! They didn't go back to California. So that was part of our findings. I would like to share that there are several things that affects the monarch population. And I think you've all heard about this nosedive in numbers. This is the Mexico population, and I'm going to pass this back to you. I've been sitting on the Monarch Butterfly Fund Board for a couple years now, and I remember when I got the phone call, we do the graphs about the year, not this winter's, but the winter before when it crashed really low. And Dr. Karen Oberhauser honestly said, you know, I feel like crying because these numbers are so low after she's been following them for so many years. This last winter they came up a little, but we're at the second lowest ever. So I'll pass that around. In California, the numbers have leveled a little bit recently, but look how high they were in the past. We do know insect populations go up and down. Okay, that's normal. We know that by crickets in our backyard and other things we see. But when we keep getting a downward trend, we get concerned. And everyone's always asking, well, what's causing this? We've seen in the news many times about the use of GMO crops. And remember, it's not the GMO crops. It's the herbicides sprayed on plants. Okay, that's the issue. That's the issue. So whenever we're using, we were talking about on the way in today, roadside mowing happens when there's milkweed growing on roadsides, and there's a lot in Arizona. When you come through and mow it all down, they can't go through that cycle. So, yes.
I saw
yes. There's a the question was with the bees, with the use of systemic pesticides, the neonicotinoids, neonics, that goes stays in the system itself, and the bees feed on it. It was affecting the bee population. They think that's one of the things. There's mites and others. They're doing studies on butterflies, and this is the preliminary information, is that it affects the larvae. So the caterpillars of monarchs would be greatly affected. All right, if you put them on a plant treated with neonics, and it's a milkweed plant, they're going to die, all right, because there's insecticide in that plant. But on a bigger scale, the adult butterflies don't seem as affected in the short term, but if neonics are nearby, and say they're applied on rose bushes, and there's some overspray, it'll affect the larvae. Even though it's not put on that plant, the larvae will be affected. Here's another study that I was told about when I was in Nevada by the University of Minnesota, who said actually bees and everything are attracted to plants with neonics that they're feeding from. It's like nicotine. All right, so they're drawn to it. And that's the problem, because they get disoriented and can't get back to their hives and things. So there's a lot of studies going on. There's a lot of studies, and it's an area of concern that we need to have more research. But what can we do? We have to be careful about what we're using in our own gardens. Okay, if we're growing plants for any butterflies, any pollinators, we have to be careful about what we're using that could affect their life cycle. And I mention that because I brought a couple milkweeds today that we had grown for you, and these plants have aphids on them. And aphids and milkweed go together, trust me. I don't think anyone's ever grown milkweed that hasn't seen aphids. You're in the breeding season here. Okay, so you have to be really careful what you do, because female monarchs are really attracted to small growth. They like the soft stuff. They know that their offspring will have a better success rate on a soft plant versus a plant that's been up for a long time. Okay, so the best thing to do is to hose these off, because we know there's no monarch eggs or anything on them right now. You can use liquid dish soap like Dawn. A teaspoon in water and spray it on 5 minutes and hose it off. But you don't want to do that if there's apes or larvae, because it'll kill them too. All right. I at home just use rubber gloves that I can throw away, you know, those disposable ones, and squish them and hose them off, and that's it. But I have been guilty of hosing off caterpillars. So I remember how I cringed when I first did that. So do be careful of anything chemical you use. 1 teaspoon to a gallon. It's a real low dilution. It doesn't need much. But you know what? The more rain you get, the more water they're exposed to, the aphid population actually goes down. They don't like water. They like it drier. Okay? On our website, we included, if you look under Monarch Waystation, some recommended plants for your elevation. All right, other host plants for other butterflies that are common here. And on the back side, plants that would help the monarchs, that we know monarchs go to. As part of our study, we went through and we tried to identify which milkweeds at each elevation do monarchs go to the most. All right, and at this elevation and higher elevation, the horsetail milkweed is always the number one plant. And I know I have a photo of it in here. No, I have a small one here, but oh, here we go. I knew if I saw it, I would see it. All right, so I'm going to pass this around. You see this on roadsides. They're very common with the white flowers. I'm finding in the northern part of the, and the white, the small white flowers. We're finding that up north, Springerville, Flagstaff, these aren't always in bloom yet because of the cool spring we had. So the monarchs will lay eggs on it anyway, but they need something else to feed on. And so make sure you include some nectar plants in your in what you're growing. Antelope horns are spider milkweed, and Fiona will be talking about her wonderful experience with this. Is what we have today. It's one of the milkweeds we have. So if you want to know what those little plants are going to look like when they grow up, this is it, okay? And we left a picture of that there. Another milkweed that grows really well that we brought small plants for is butterfly weed. Okay, this is the only milkweed that does not milk. All the others, when you break a leaf, will milk. Okay, so this one will not. And monarchs don't use it as heavily as a host plant, but they do use it, and we have a lot of documentation of it. But you'll always see all kinds of butterflies on its flowers when it's blooming. So that is the other one on the bottom here that we have. I'd like you to see other ones that are common out here. The Mojave milkweed. And a lot of these milkweeds will come up in the spring and they'll die back sometime during the summer or in the fall, depending on when they first came up. If we have a really good monsoon season, sometimes you'll get a second growth in the fall. And this one I know is out here, and I would love some information about it. It's called Asclepias latifolia broadleaf or popcorn milkweed. We have seen in the northern part of the state, it always draws ants. There's ants all over it. Ants eat monarch eggs, and small caterpillars, so we never see larvae. I would love to see if you see any monarch caterpillars on that particular one. Trying to think, is there anything else? The information that we included, like I mentioned on the website, of how to grow, are also included in this brochure, Monarch Waystations, that we have along with us today. And we also have some bookmarks. All of these on this table here are free. We have some plants in the Burpees Bee Garden as well. And if you want to know what's in here, I have opened one packet. These are free. The plants are $3 each. I'm going to turn this over to Fiona, and I know we're going to introduce you to Kathy and Bob, who are local participants from our Southwest Monarch City, to talk about what they're doing with tagging here. Okay, that's a good clarification. Did I say that on tuberosa will not be used as a host plant? It will be. It's not used as extensively as the others. All right, the Sylvertus salato is number one at this elevation. The lower elevations have another one, yeah. Yes. Very good point. Be careful with buying plants that are labeled that they're treated with neonics, okay? Because that can stay in the plant for quite a long period of time. How about if you talk and let me talk about Kurosawa milkweed at the end?
Actually, I don't really need to read anything, so I don't need my glasses. Anyway, it's great to see everybody out here interested in monarch butterflies and in pollinator-type gardens. I've been looking around at everybody. I hardly know a soul here, so I guess that's because you're all heads down in your gardens all day, every day, kind of like me. And your hands, too, look like gardener's hands. So in 2012, I got a phone call from a friend of mine saying that they had given my name to the Xerces Society, which is an insect conservation society. And because they knew that I had some land down in Skull Valley, and where we have a small vineyard, the Painted Lady Vineyard. And because they were looking for somebody perhaps locally to experiment and grow milkweed. So I spoke to the gal. I was really keen on getting the milkweed, and she asked me tons of questions about time I had, etc. I said, oh no, it's okay, I get lots of volunteers. Anyway, we ended up in June 2012, I don't know if you remember, that was really, really hot.
Yeah.
Prior to June 2012, all the months coming up to it, I had to prepare some land, some space, for over 2,000 milkweed plants. That involved clearing the land, putting down some irrigation initially, because all these plants need a little water to begin their lives, and actually I don't water it anymore, and they just pop up. So piping and all weed fabric, and then we think, well, how are we going to make holes in the bee? So just for the plug of milkweed that we're going to get, we needed these holes, and so a friend of mine designed a wonderful system. He's a welder. He would heat up in a little burner, a little thing with a round end on it, and just every 2 feet, put a hole and burn the weed fabric. We had mulch delivered and all kinds of things, lots of volunteer help, including children, which was wonderful. And in June 2012, we planted over 2,000 Asclepias asperula, the spider milkweed, or antelope horn milkweed. And so it was June. By August, early September, we began to see monarch butterflies. I've saw caterpillars, and I was really, really excited that this thing was going to take off. And I don't do anything to those asperulas anymore except to try and keep them weeded in spite of the weed fabric. We have, my biggest issue with keeping these plants alive has been gophers. Interestingly enough, because you wonder if the underneath part of the plant tastes as bad as the above part of the plant, which is why the
the larvae, the monarch larvae, are not basically preyed upon as much as they probably would be. They taste pretty nasty, and butterfly too. So this was a great experiment, and except for basically keeping the thing we did, Gail talked about aphids, and we have had masses of aphids, and you know, my first thought was, okay, I can hose them off. You can't hose off 2,000 milkweeds unless you've got all week to do nothing else, because you do have to be careful, and the aphids like to be underneath the leaves, so you've got to bend down 2,000 times and get the year. So, and actually, but the aphids don't bother anything else. I was worried about the vineyard. Am I going to have all kinds of awful insect populations on the vines? And no. So the aphids are just on the milkweed, and you finally have to sort of, it's okay, this is part of the milkweed life, farming milkweed life, anyway. The other thing, so the gophers are a tougher issue because I've got to find them and trap them. Not my favorite part of the job. You also have to cut through the weed fabric, and so all your hard work for weed fabric has gone down the tubes. So the gophers, the aphids, and then this is another thing that will defoliate your milkweed. These are tussock moth caterpillars. Who brought these in? Somebody brought them in. You did. Yeah. So again, it's kind of like, what am I going to do? So my plan, I was just looking at my milkweed patches this morning, and what I'm going to do is to cut off, just like you did here, cut off the branches with all these caterpillars on and put them in a big bucket and take them far away. But actually, first thing I wanted just to see if some other plant is their host plant. Then I'm going to take them away and move them somewhere else, and good luck. I can't actually kill them. I think it's called a milkweed tusk moth. Tussock. T-U-S-S-O-C-K. Yeah. I suppose I could designate one out of 2,000, but they won't stay there. They won't stay there. And they also like the horsetail milkweed. They're on that as well. And they defoliate them so quickly. So it's kind of, you've got to be there, catch them before they do all of that stuff. As far as growing it, so when you do grow your milkweed, you can actually harvest the seed before it flies away, because they all attach to a little bit of silk, basically attached to the seed, and the wind, when the pod gets dry and pops open, then the wind will disperse the seeds. If you can catch it in time, put a little sack, like a little mesh net or something over it, and tie it underneath the pod when it's beginning to look dry. You can then catch the seeds, and you can separate the seeds from the silk, and you can plant your own seeds. And growing milkweed seed, all my seeds, when I get a lot of seeds, they don't weigh very much, go to Underwood Gardens or Terroir Seeds in Chino Valley. And they sell them. You need a license to sell seed. I can't go there. So they sell my seed. I'm happy to give away seed when I have a lot. And I've had fantastic success germinating it, but I have not had great success transplanting it from a teeny tiny plug into a bigger pot. And I don't know what I did wrong. I really do need to replant where the gophers have killed my milkweed. But other people have. And obviously, this gentleman here in...
Where was it?
In Wilhoyt?
No.
Oh, Wickenburg? Obviously, did really well. Don't give up. Don't give up, because I'm going to try again. And I actually have... I only printed 10 copies. Anyway, you'll have to fight. But what will happen is that this PDF on how to cold stratify your milkweed seed, which really is a good thing to do. If you lay your hands on some milkweed seed now, cold stratify them for the month, perfect timing to perhaps put them out. A month. That's what I did. I followed these instructions to the T, and it worked. And yeah, I'll get to you just now. Yeah. But harvest your own seed, when you get some, any kind, doesn't matter. In fact, the more the merrier. Follow these instructions and they will be on a PDF on Watts' Garden Center website.
Right, and along with the video that will be going out for all of those of you that are signing the email, we'll get an email that will contain the video that we're doing here.
Okay, so the PDF on how to grow this, it's really fun to try and do these things. When I did, maybe I should have moved them from the plug to the garden instead of from the plug to another bigger pot. I don't know. I just spent so much time wandering around my large garden watering different little plants and things like that I think they would have got lost because they would have been too small.
So you grow from seed?
I did not grow the original from seed. I had over 2,000 plugs come from a nursery in California from seed that was grown in Humboldt. So that was a very, very local seed. And yes, I am trying to replace gopher-killed milkweed with my own seeds. So it's still a challenge. I'm still on it. Suzanne, you had a question?
I was just going to say on the transplanting from the germination stage, I've been trying the last year or two and found that if I actually cold stratified them in the little peat pots, the little tiny peat
Oh, yes.
Pots,
oh, really?
I put them in my refrigerator. And then had them germinate, and then just had those little peat things then out on my porch so they got big enough to transplant to the ground. I had a much better success than trying to pick up my little
interesting
old stratified seeds.
Very good. Very good. If you can get your hands on something called an L pot, ELLE, that's what my original crop was planted in, and they're made of a lovely biodegradable substance. And it's so easy to poke out of the special planting plastic box thing with all the holes in. And that would work too, because they're very, very sturdy. But when I was trying to push the soil up out of this little hole, it all collapsed. It was not a good thing, I'm learning. But Bob Gessner, right? Yes, do something in between there.
I'm gonna jump in here. Koya brought her vase of flowers so you could see seed pods of the Sabruta salata as well. The seed pods look a little different on every milkweed, okay? You will notice a lot of milkweeds will have a little red and black bug. It's called a milkweed bug, interesting, okay? And they will try to get at those seeds, all right? And if they do, before you do, they'll be infertile. Will render them infertile. So a lot of times when you see seed pods open and you want to collect them, you don't know how good they are. Right? I mean, so we have learned, and you've had some similar things, that a lot of times people have a really hard time starting milkweed. Bob and Kathy have done well, but a lot of times people have a real hard time. So that was why we started making sure plugs were available. Monarch Watch is offering plugs for the lower elevations. We provided seed from pine, same elevation, and that's what these are from. So we kind of, that's the fun thing about being affiliated with both Monarch Watch and Southwest Monarch Study. We can make both happen. And we just really feel more need to be available to the higher elevation. I want to mention something about one other milkweed that's been in the news, tropical milkweed. You might have heard about it. It's called Asclepias curassavica, all right? There's pictures of it on our website. It's a yellow flower with orange or sometimes all yellow. It's been big in the news. It's that it's not native, which is true. It's native to Mexico, Central America, and the Caribbean. But it is all around the overwintering sites. And a lot of native plant nurseries in southern Arizona grow it because it's within the 500 miles of that area. The study that came out was done along the coast of Texas and that area where it's very humid and very hot. That particular milkweed has naturalized, and so they are saying that milkweed was causing an increase in a disease called OE. I'm not going to say the big Latin one for you. We all call it OE. And this is a disease that's been part of monarchs forever. All right, I want to be real clear on that. When Monarch Health did a study on this,
They said that Western monarchs, 30% of them have OE, Eastern monarchs, 15%, and in year-round populations, it was as high as 80 to 90%. And so when monarchs started spending the winter, there was a chance for this disease to build up because they were interbreeding a lot. All right. It's a spore, and the spores would drop on plants, and then the caterpillars would go and eat them, and so they would get infected. So it wasn't only from breeding, it was passed on. The issue is not the milk back. Remember we were talking about with Fiona and all the milkweeds that grow at this level, they die back. And this particular area along the Gulf Coast, they lived all winter and started naturalizing, and the monarchs started breeding on them all winter long. In Arizona, we have four evergreen milkweeds that are here all the time. We're very unique in that. And they're almost all the desert species live year round, always have. And so we took over 400 samples over 5 years of monarchs to test them for this disease OE. And our disease rate, 4%. All right, it's not an issue here. It's not an issue here, even in the deserts where there are monarchs. We need to continue monitoring, you know, in the deserts particularly. Here they die back. You can grow the milkweed from seed. It'll bloom right away. That's the nice thing about it. But in the southern deserts, you know, I always encourage people, if they have that milkweed and it's making it through the winter, that they're testing their monarchs, but it is not a major concern. So I do want you to know that. We put some information about that on our website, again, so make sure you're aware of that. This one, Monarch Watch gift shop online. Same thing with this one. This is a new one that just came out by Xerces about the migration, all right? And they were kind enough to give us a good JPEG to be able to blow it up and use it in our presentations. It's a little more accurate with what we're seeing with the breeding, especially in the southern part of the state. We talked about monarch caterpillars and what they look like. We said monarchs and queens use milkweed. You need to know what a queen caterpillar looks like. Go on our website. Make sure you look. It's monarch, queen, and if you're seeing them in parsley, dill, rue, you likely have a black swallowtail. All right? Look on our website to see the differences because the coloration is the same. All right? Monarchs, if you notice in your handout there in that little brochure, have two sets of filaments, one set at each end of their body. A queen will have a third set. So M is before Q, 2 before 3. Okay, that's your way to remember in the field. Okay, Bob and Kathy do a lot locally. They're part of the Southwest Monarch Study. They've been outstanding in everything they've been doing in the Prescott area. So, Kathy, I'm going to toss this in. That's a good question. What does the OE disease do? When they happen to get it, they can when they come out of a chrysalis, their wings can be very deformed. So they can't pull out and survive. Usually they're weaker. A lot of times they get culled out in the migration. They can't make it. They aren't as healthy as the others, so they're not always the premier mates for breeding.
I'm Kathy Palm-Gessner, and my husband Bob. I was a biology teacher, so you should be able to hear me in the back. But anyways, we're the local reps for Southwest Monarch Study. And last year was the first year that we got some data. I have about 160 people that are signed up for spotting or even tagging. If you would like to be a part of this, I have a clipboard. We'll have it up here. Bob, you want to be in charge of that one? You can tell I'm a teacher. All right, so anyways, if you would like to be a local rep, you know, Chino Valley, just the whole area here, I even have some people on Camp Verde that report into me as far as seeing caterpillars and adult monarchs and so on. And then I send out emails. I try not to do a lot, but every once in a while letting you know what's happening locally as far as the amount of monarchs coming through. We actually spotted about 470 monarchs here last year. Again, you know, no monarchs in Arizona. Well, we even have in Prescott. We tagged about 130. I will be having tagging workshops later on. If you're interested, sign up on the clipboard, put down tagging workshop, and then I'll be emailing out once we get some more monarchs in the area. Just today, let's see, Karen in the back on Williamson Valley Road, she brought in a photo. She saw a monarch on, what plant was it, Karen?
Butterfly
bush, okay. And she took a photo, so we have a verification. So far we've had two, and because it's so easily easy to mistake them with the queen, that we, this is data for Southwest Monarch Study. So we really do need verification for the first monarchs that you start seeing. So you can sign up there, or if you want to just sign up to get the email, see what's going on in the area. Anything else, Bob? Yes?
When a monarch is recovered in California or Mexico, do you get the actual number of that?
Okay. Yeah, we do. They usually give us photos of the ones in California, and those are pretty much all live sightings. In Mexico, yeah, you can get a photo with your, yeah. Yeah, our tag. You can do it, and usually you can zoom it in and read the number. In Mexico, usually those are monarchs that have died, all right? And the guides there collect them. We pay them 50 pesos per tag as a way of income. These people are very poor. We've been there several times. Bob and Kathy joined us the last time we went, and we were hoping to go again. They're on horses. They don't always have plumbing in their houses. So the pesos we give them is literally shoes for their children's feet. All right. So that is why we have that arrangement with them. So there's only been one live sighting of ours in Mexico, and that was one tagged in my backyard in Chandler, in Kino Bay on the coast. Sonora was seen. Someone that came to a workshop just like this, was visiting down there, saw a tag monarch appear in front of her. Yes?
So, you can wear the...
Over winter? Mm-hmm. Yes. Because the people are poor in Mexico, they're cutting the trees. Yes and no. We work on the Monarch Butterfly Fund Board to train people how to grow trees so in 7 years they can cut a portion of those for their firewood and leave the rest for the forest. Okay. Well, not the local people. Not the local people. That's illegal logging going on. And yes, unfortunately, there's been an increase lately. In the area after it was getting better, and now it's kind of resurfaced again. So yeah, and that's a concern because they go back, monarchs tend to go back to the same areas, and when we start losing the tree density, colder temperatures could start affecting the monarchs. Yes, it's a concern.
So I went to the wintering site this February. You have to go because it's breathtaking. You cannot, I mean, my hack is, you know, my hair's going up on the back of my neck here because I remember it, it's breathtaking. If you get a chance to go down, it's in Michoacan, and it's, Michoacan has a bad rep, but it's perfectly safe and wonderful and beautiful, and there are guides who can take you there, and they speak wonderful English. But as far as the logging of stuff, I was really, really pleased to see that when you go up to these three overwintering sites and you take a hike or a horse, you can take a little horse up there, there are local Mexicans, they might not speak a word of English, and they're standing at, they flag off different areas with tape, basically, because who knows which tree the monarchs are gonna land on, basically, and they don't want you up close all the time to the trees that are weighed down by the weight of butterflies. And they'll stand there and they'll just ask you, you're quiet, everybody's whispering. It's a very silent place in the forest as you watch these millions and millions of butterflies. And it's unbelievable. And the local people, from old grannies to little kids, are there to watch and make sure that you are quiet and that you don't disturb anything else. So they really do care. I mean, they can see a good reason to keep on doing this, because at the bottom of the mountain you get all these lovely Mexican snacks and things like that. Tortillas and quesadillas and
margaritas.
Oh yeah, well no, not down there, but yes.
The only time I really came across the Mexican military with guns, I mean, yes, they're walking around guns, but the one time I really saw them with them up was when they were making trucks slow down because monarchs were crossing the road, and they were coming right across the roadway, and they stopped all the trucks, and if they went through, those guns went up with a yell, you know what I mean? So they're very protective of the monarchs there, extremely so, yes. Oh, okay, I apologize. If whoever has the photos, if they could come back up, we're happy to leave them here so you could look at them. I apologize. Are they on their way? Yeah, okay, they're working their way back down. They're working. Okay, yes. Could anyone forward the question? I can't hear you. Do you want to come up? No, I'm sorry. That's a real good question. Minimum number. Remember, think butterfly. You're a butterfly flying somewhere. Okay, what's going to draw you to someone's yard? It's mass numbers. A minimum, they recommend, of 10 milkweeds. Now, that does not mean you need to have them all at one time. I have a friend who has three, and she drew them to their yard with three, and every year she just kept adding on another one. But keep in mind, not only milkweed for breeding, we need fall nectar, rabbit brush, sunflowers, tithonia, cosmos. Any of those plants will feed the monarchs on their journey. Those are the ones they favor the most. Any other questions? You've been so patient, yes.
You mentioned a horsetail milkweed.
Yes.
What's preferred above 5,000 feet. You didn't say what's preferred between 5,000 and the rest of the
area. High or low?
Lower.
Lower elevation, actually in the lower desert area, it's subulata, desert milkweed, Asclepias subulata. That was probably the number one favorite down there, but there are others in that area as well. Pine leaf milkweed, Arizona milkweed, there's a whole list. They're all on our page, on our website, with the thing. So yeah, they like them all. We were just giving you the most favorite that they kept going to. Sedona?
Spider milkweed is there.
Yeah. The Asperla will grow at that elevation, as well as the Mojave milkweed. That's at all of the elevations in Arizona. Yeah, but I know there's horsetail in Sedona because I know at Red Rock State Park they have a lot of horsetail milkweed growing there.
Around here. You may have noticed that the horsetail milkweed, this one right here, is blooming right now. And it appears, now this is only after 1 year of collecting data, so you know this is just a guess, that it appears that this is the biggie for the monarchs coming in right now, because it is blooming.
Well, it's their number one.
Yeah, so that's why it's number one. That, as far as our records last year too, as far as finding them on these.
It's number one across the state. Let me tell you this real quick. This is my last final thing. In every June, July, we travel around key breeding sites around Arizona. All right? And we look at what is the population like. And that becomes a harbinger of the fall migration. All right? That's just what we're seeing in Arizona. That doesn't count what's coming in from up north of us, all right? I want to be real clear on this. However, when we went to the White Mountains and we looked at the sites, by now they should have 20 to 30 monarchs flying. And we went to six different sites and only two had monarchs, and there was one in each site. I'm concerned. all right? I'm really concerned because in 8 years of data, I've never seen it this low. That being said, there could be caterpillars galore everywhere that I didn't see. They could be immature. And keep in mind, in another week or two, we're going to get an influx of monarchs coming in from the north, that first wave that's going to come through laying eggs. So we need your sightings. Also, keep in mind, email us as well. Our email is on the brochures, our Facebook page. We need to know what you're seeing because that becomes part of our data, all right, for a future paper. Thank you so much for your time, your patience. Thank you, everybody.
Growing in my yard, the horsetail or world, as it's called, and I photographed the metamorphosis of that butterfly to its release. And this is she. I named her Maya in honor of Maya Angelou, who taught us so much about freedom and emergence. And this is really, in addition to seeing Gail and Fiona last year at the Highland Center of Natural History, was what encouraged me to just really chase the monarchs, as you might say. So